pleased tonight to have another one of our panel discussion events, in this particular case, discussing the current state of the shipping industry. The genesis of this particular panel discussion relates to a few things, and I want to just bring them up briefly. When I was the executive vice president, and I'm still on the board of the Hellenic American Chamber of Commerce, one of the things that was brought to my attention, because their particular chamber relates to shipping, but one of the things that was brought to my attention was something that happened historically. And what happened historically relates to World War II. And the fact that we had Orchid Day recently brings this up to mind. So what is that scenario? Prior to Greece actually entering the war, when the Nazis invaded after the Hellenic Republic pushed back the fascists in Albania, what used to happen is, as country after country fell in Europe, more and more there was a reliance on Hellenic shipping to ship those armaments into Europe, to ship the supplies that would require. And what took place is there was an analysis and discovery that in fact they were Hellenic ships, and in particular they were targeted by the Nazis during that period. During that period, 2,000 seamen lost their lives, 3/4 of the fleet was destroyed, and that really stuck in my mind. And because of that, when in fact the war ended, the United States in particular focused on the Hellenic shipping shippers, and basically started to sell them in particular the Liberty ships, what they call the blessed Liberty ships, which was the formation of the modern Hellenic fleet, which right now is, the panelists know better than I do, is the largest shipping fleet in the world. What many people don't know is that prior to the war, from the 19th century, in fact, the Hellenic shipping fleet was being built. And by the 1930s, actually, before the war even started, they were one of the major shipping fleets in the world, actually heading towards a trajectory to become the world's largest fleet. So with things that are happening in Hellenic Republic in particular, we came up with the concept of doing something that is only appropriate, which is basically to work on establishing, working with the politicians, et cetera, finding a piece of property here in Long Manhattan in particular, to create a monument to those seamen who lost their lives, who basically were the lifeline of Europe, of the what has now become the countries of the EU, and in fact, a thank you to the United States for providing those Liberty ships. So the way we envision this particular monument, and we're just a spokesperson for this concept, and we obviously are going to try to engage others in creating this monument that we're basically talking about. So many people have forgotten the linkages between the U.S. and the Hellenic Republic. People talk about the concept more recently of the lazy Greek and all this other type of stuff, and this has infuriated people like me in the diaspora. And we also believe that these particular concepts, and as is indicated in Pew research that came up with statistics of how Europeans feel about the people in the Hellenic Republic, it's obvious that over time, okay, the concept will also come into the diaspora. Who are you? You're a Hellenic American. What does that really mean? Oh, are you associated with the lazy Greeks, et cetera, et cetera? So we have to, in our organization and the other organizations, push back against this. And this is part of a series of things that we're going to have in terms of the different industries that are doing quite well, actually. This is one of the most prominent industries that we have. So that's part of what we're doing here tonight. So the concept came up, and we said, when we were talking to the people at EMCOR, let's have a shipping panel discussion, because it relates to some of this historical stuff that we were talking about. One of the things I'd like to do before I introduce the panel, and I'm also going to have the Council General speak to us a couple of words, is we had our September event, which related to Professor Alexiou's Hellenic American project that the Prime Minister of the Hellenic Republic attended. We had stated that we would give 5 scholarships to the students who are involved in the program at Queens College, and in fact promote the archival program that Professor Alexiou has put together. On the last panel discussion that we had, which was related to the development, design, and construction, which we had at the Russian Tea Room a couple of weeks ago, on November 3rd, we handed out 3 of those scholarships, and tonight we're going to hand out another 2. So, if Professor Alexiou is here. So, the particular students that we're going to hand out scholarships are not here today because they're doing research. So just explain the research that they're doing.
We are documenting at this moment, this particular part of the research is to document the stereotype of Greek Americans, the Greek dance. So the team is in Philadelphia at this moment, and they're shooting one of the oldest Greek American dances. They just finished some shootings in the Midwest. And pretty soon we're coming to New York. I would like to thank NCAP and Mr. Lukacs in particular for this support, because research is not an individual thing. Research belongs to the public domain. And the Greek American community, although it is a community with many successes, especially in economic and the social upward mobility, we're not very good in supporting research and the arts. I think what EMCA does, being an organization, both cultural and business organization, attempts to fill this gap. And thank you very much for this.
So the 2 scholarships we're going to award is the Lambrini Thoma and Nikolaos Venturas. Project that we're talking about, the monument that we're talking about. So they're also going to engage in some of the research that relates to these mariners that lost their lives at sea, and also to the American side of it. And our hope is obviously when we get the location, because politics are involved in that, to raise the money to create the monument and then bring representatives of both the Hellenic government and the US government together. The other thing we want to do is, and we had met with some people relating to the trireme. So you say, well, you know, why did you have the trireme as the symbol on the website for this particular event? The other thing we want to do is, when we push forward for the site, when we in fact erect this monument, we also want to be involved with bringing in the Olympias trireme from Athens into New York, and it will be a great thing to do. So, what's happening? St. Nicholas is going up, the patron saint of the seamen. The monument, okay, both dedicated to the United States and to the Hellenic Republic. And at the same time, bringing in the trireme. I think it's a hit, it's a good thing to have, and we can do it. So what I'd like to do now is, because all of you, of course, are waiting for the panel discussion on shipping, so I'd like to introduce the moderator, Fotis Yannakoulis, who will take over from here. But before I introduce him, I'm going to introduce the Consul General to say a few words, Konstantin Boudros.
First, 30 seconds for my part. From the very beginning, ladies and gentlemen, from the very first day that I was here, one of the first people that I met was Lukacs and Professor Alexiou. What unique personalities in many aspects. I would like only to congratulate both of you for the initiatives that you have taken already and the ones that you're going to take in the future, because I'm sure that your projects are going to be continued. And to underline the word that you said, my dear friend Lou, to engage more people, to get more involved. This is the issue. This is what we need here in the United States. The green community has the capacity to go forward and to promote the ideas that we have seen President Obama presented yesterday to the people, not only in Greece, but in the world. Thank you very much.
I'd like to personally thank you and the panel for agreeing to come tonight. It's a great topic. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Lou. Thank you, John, Mr. Councilor. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's a great pleasure, and thank you for connecting us with the rest of the world, because we, the people that we work in the shipping industry, we tend to be very inward-looking. We tend to speak with each other within the shipping industry and to focus on only on this industry, which is really fascinating. But in reality, there is a much broader world, and this world, I think, deserves to know what shipping is about. I started in shipping 15 years ago, actually, it's a little bit more. I didn't know anything about shipping except Onassis, Niarchos, and all these big legends of this industry. And I always thought that when you go abroad, Greece is a small little country, but the first trip that I had when I went abroad, I came actually here in the US, and I went to my bank with other Americans, Norwegians, and Singaporeans. It was an international crowd, and everybody felt and know, say, just telling them that I'm Greek. So I felt really proud to be Greek, being in shipping, and everybody was telling me, you know about shipping, and I had just started. They had no idea what shipping was about. So I was looking at some numbers earlier before I come, numbers on which I did not spend so much time, but I went to the Clarkson database to see how many ships the Greek fleet has, and I saw that they were 4,911. That is, in terms of values, is almost $100 billion worth of assets in today's values, but they are down 60-70% from the peak. This is approximately 14-15% of the global fleet. It's by far the largest shipping nation in the world. 20% of the dry bulk industry, and 23% of the tanker industry. There are 898 companies based in Greece alone. 17% of the Greek GDP, and the contribution of shipping to the Greek GDP is enormous, especially if you take into consideration, and despite all these people that sometimes they complain about shipping, about taxation and all that, there has not been any single investment from the public to the shipping industry, and despite that, the shipping industry contributes 17% of the GDP without asking for anything. So this is clearly a very important, and it's a representative of our nation in the world, although I would say that some of our panelists will confirm that it's not very well known even in Greece, because apparently there are a couple of islands that they dominate the Greek shipping. Apostolos, Tsitsirakis from Tsakos Energy Navigation. It's a Chios-based, Chios-born company,
right.
And also Tassos, who is from the same island, they know. So let me introduce the panel first. We have Apostolos from Tsakos Energy. Apostolos has done a lot of things in shipping, from being a ship broker to getting involved into the supplies, bunker supplies, getting involved in one of the first IPOs in the Greek invasion of 2005 in the US, and I'm an offspring of this invasion, and that's when I came to New York. And now he's with one of the largest tanker companies in the world. And Tassos Pantelias, we met with Tassos when Tassos was running the fleet of Mantinia Shipping, and He was the general manager there. He was an operational guy, but in reality, he was the man that was doing everything there together with Fotini Karamanlis. But before that, he was a broker. He lived in Singapore working for the Karnaises family. And now he's, he took my old job. He's a banker now. And probably later on, he will become a shipping analyst. Tasos Aslidis, I have said that many times, Tasos Aslidis is sort of my mentor in the industry. He gave me the first introduction to the shipping industry at this trip to the US, my first job in shipping. He came from Boston and he was a shipping consultant at that time. And that was the first presentation about shipping that I ever attended. And today, Tasos is the CFO of a publicly listed company, Eurosys, that is involved in both container ships and tankers.
And dry bulk vessels.
So that's a tough market, Tasos. Do you want to tell us a few things about your sectors? Tell us what your ships do. What are the segments in shipping, just for the audience that is not involved, to understand what kind of vessels you have?
First of all, thank you very much, Lou, for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to be here and part of this discussion in the forum on shipping. I'm not from Chios myself. The principals of the company are. I'm from Thessaloniki, just to put the record the record straight. Our company owns ships, of course, two types, dry bulk and container. Very briefly, dry bulk ships carry commodities in bulk, carry grain, carry coal, carry iron ore. These are the big industrial commodities, and the ships are the big movers of these commodities. Container ships carry the goods that are produced using these commodities and other materials. The big innovation that took place in the industry after so many thousands of years was in the 60s, here in the States, actually, where the first container ship was introduced. The idea was to put the commodities in boxes, so to unify the way you store them and not to have specialized ships. So you have one type of ship for many commodities that are all in the same box. So we carry, some of our ships carry containers, and those carry finished goods. Typically, finished goods are produced in the low-cost countries in the Far East, and are being transported to the consuming countries, Europe, US, but increasingly more now all over the world.
Apostola, do you want to talk a little bit about tankers? What type of tankers, what kind of vessels you are involved, what is your company is doing?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Lou, thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to express and promote our business, which, as you very correctly said, people don't know that much about. And just to complement what you said earlier, the shipping business, the global shipping business, it's a $500 billion business. Just to put it in perspective, the TV, the video business, you know, the Hollywood business, it's $85 billion business. So that gives you an idea of how big shipping is. And 15% of that being Greek, it's almost $75 billion.
It's actually 100.
It's 100, okay. So this is controlled by Greek-owned companies worldwide. Just an asterisk to show how important this business is, not just for Greece, but for the world in general. Our company, Tsakos Energy Navigation, is involved in the tanker business, meaning the transportation of crude oil and petroleum products. The company's been around for many years as a public company. It's been around since 92. It was first listed in the Oslo Stock Exchange back in 92. Consequently, it was listed on the New York Stock Exchange in 2002. We control a fleet of approximately 65 tankers, ranging all the way from VLCCs that carry 2 million barrels of crude oil, all the way down to product tankers that can carry 45 to 50,000 metric tons of petroleum products. And we have also gotten involved in the LNG business. We do own and operate two LNG carriers, which is, as we believe, the future, that are currently trading terms of how this business is structured, the companies deal with all the oil major companies, with all the well-known traders of the world. We carry crude oil and petroleum products worldwide, all the ports, all the export countries, all the refining facilities are our clients. And as a strategy, the company wants to become an industrial concern, meaning we go where our clients require us to go. So we don't speculatively try and acquire vessels. We only buy vessels according to the client's requirements and needs. As such, we have been, we are currently the biggest provider of services for Statoil, the Norwegian oil company. And this is interesting because Norwegians do have a very long track record in shipping. However, Statoil decided to do this business with us, with a Greek company. And it was actually caused a question to be raised in the Norwegian parliament, why Statoil decided to do business with a Greek company. And the answer was very simple. It was all about quality and about continuation of services and the ability to perform a long-term contract, because the contract is for up to 15 years. The company is the offspring of a family behind the Tsakos family that has been in the shipping business for almost three generations. Captain Panagiotis has been one of the most prominent figures in shipping business. Nicholas Tsakos is the CEO of our company, and we look forward to, you know, bring the company to the next generation and the next circle of the shipping business.
Tasos, you have done everything in shipping, and you have worked from privately owned companies to public companies, and now you are dealing with the capital markets. How's the Greek shipping changed all these years? What is different, and how the Greek ship owner has evolved? Are there any differences from the first family-owned company to the company that we see right now, the people that they are involved in today's market?
It's a good question, Fotis, and thank you all for having us here this evening. I think, as a Greek, shipping is in our blood, and personally, and I think I speak for the panel, it's a source of great pride, because Greece is a country of 10 million people that doesn't have a lot of natural resources, but it excels at shipping. And I think the roots of this comes from the fact that the country is an island-based country, and for generations we've sailed and traded around the Mediterranean. And from these roots, we've established a tradition and an expertise, which thankfully is something that we've managed to retain over the generations. And we operate the preeminent shipping business, shipping center in the world. And not to be underestimated, shipping represents over 90% of all global trade. And it surprised me when I came to the USA how little is known about the industry, given how important it is for the global industry. As far as the Greek shipping model, I mean, traditionally the companies grew up through families, captains who bought the first ship, traded it, if they were successful, managed to buy a second ship. And so this is why we find ourselves with such a wide range of shipping companies and a concentration of shipping expertise in our country, which I think is unparalleled in any other place. These companies were always growing within their means, within the trade pattern they were involved in. But we've seen this model evolve over the last, I would say, 15, 20 years, away from the traditional shipping model where there would be a family members would be involved in the business, and they would operate a small fleet, four or five ships, and grow the business in that manner. I think as the business has evolved, we're seeing shipping companies become more corporate. We're seeing them go outside the traditional shipping model where the family is key. We're bringing in new investors. We're looking at growing these companies through tapping capital markets such as the US stock markets, debt markets around the world. And I think now we're seeing the next generation, which hasn't necessarily grown up at sea previously. These are the sons and and the offspring of the original ship owners who have probably spent more time at Harvard than on board a ship necessarily. And I think now they're marrying the traditional expertise that the country possesses with a new skill set, allowing these companies to grow. You know, Chagos is a prime example. It's a traditional company that's embraced the opportunities, saw the opportunities in the market to become greater than the sum of its parts previously, and was one of the first companies, if not the first, to go public in the Greek shipping industry. And I see this general trend developing. I think the family model is going to generally evolve into a more substantial companies looking at the public space and more corporate in their profile.
I think if I can answer on that is that it used to be the common saying in shipping was that the ship is the firm. Every ship, for various reasons, legal and others, still is organized as a separate company. But in the past, because of the more difficult communications and what have you, the owner, the captain, was going on the ship, going from one port to the other, and the next port was trying to find employment to go to the following port, and so on and so forth. I mean, the grandfather of Aristides Peters, who is one of the founders of my company, used to credit himself as being the first person to centralize finding cargoes back in the 100 years ago. To have someone on shore to look for cargoes for the next voyage of the ship. And as communications developed and the world got more linked, this single ship model has become more and more corporate. Also, for all the other reasons that the generations turn the baton from one to the other, and people get more educated. So we have a natural evolution from what it was an optimal model, one vessel, one firm.
One family.
To more or less to a fully blown corporate model that we have these days.
Apostle, I want to follow. I want you to follow up on something that Tassos said, that right now you have capital markets, you have the new generation that has spent more time at Harvard than at sea. I don't know, is this good or bad? Because when I started in shipping, there were no US investors, there were no capital markets, they were only the shipping company, the ship owners and the families. And when the good times would come, they would take all the froth of the market, they would take advantage of it. Right now, it feels like that there are thousands of people involved into the industry. Everybody's trying to make a deal. How can Greek shipping survive in this environment when there is so much competition? And what is the uniqueness? And what makes Greek shipping to stay in Greece? And why your company has not been to Malta, to Cyprus, to Singapore? What keeps you there?
Right. I think the answer is somewhere in the middle. The family model, as described, has been what worked perfect for the past 100 years. And it was the only way a business, a very difficult business, could eventually improve. As, of course, the world evolved and economies changed, this model has to change, and it has to do with strategic planning and analytics. It has to do with financial analysis and financial management. Now, all this is perfect, and as you said, when the markets were at its peak, it didn't really matter if the principal is a captain or it's an owner that might be his side business, shipping, while he's doing something else. However, I think the secret of the success of the Greek shipping has been the instinct of the previous generation. And this has been proved by the way the market and the Greek shipping has survived and has been successful throughout the years. It's not an understatement to say that all the owners of the world, including Norwegians and Japanese and even US owners, look at what the Greek owners are doing at every point in the cycle before they decide their next business move. So it has been a lot about the instinct and a lot about the knowledge of the previous generation, who most of them have been captains or engineers or people who have spent a lot of time traveling on board the vessels. And they have managed to pass this knowledge to the next generation. I would say that the answer is somewhere in the middle. We need to have, of course, the institutionalization of the business and the know-how and the sophistication that comes with being a public company or dealing with financial institutions and all the private equity guys right now. But at the same time, we also need to have the bottom line of the business, which is the instinct, which is the knowledge that all these people have amassed throughout the years and have successfully, I must say, passed to the next generation. So most of the Greek companies right now, if you look back into their history, they do have someone, one of the principals, that's either a captain or an engineer or is somehow involved in the business. And I think no matter how many years go by, eventually Greek shipping companies will always have a percentage of this type of personalities within their organization.
At the same time, this might be a proof of the great DNA in ingenuity. Shipping is one of the most free industries to compete with it. Give a Greek an open field and he will run. Look at all of you. I mean, you came here to this country and everybody has been very successful. Shipping is a fork of the US on the transportation scene. There are few barriers, there used to be, still there are relatively few barriers to entry, few regulation, although increasing. So it's an environment where what we want to take pride of our Greek DNA thrives on. So this is what I think kept Greek shipping prominent throughout the centuries.
Dr. Aslidis, you are a doctor, you have a doctorate degree, and you are an engineer. And I'm an analytical person, and sometimes I try to exercise the idea of instinct. And when I first joined shipping, I sat across another ship owner from Chios. And I asked him what the market is going to do, and he said, my gut tells me. And when I said, what your gut tells you, how do you rely on your gut on this investment, no analytical study, he said, I went to Australia and I touched the grain. The year that is going to be very good. Can you tell us that since both you and Aristides Peters, the CEO of the company, are engineers, how do you make an investment, and how do you view the decision-making process evolving and differing between your approach and the private equities that you are working with, the way that the private equities take decision? Is it analytical, is it analysis, or is it gut feeling?
I think it's mostly analytical these days. I think there's so much information about the industry and so much ability to analyze it. It's a sin not to analyze it and use it. And what really, there used to be a say that God gave oil to Arabs and Norwegians to Greeks. It was when Norwegians were stealing, Greeks were buying it, that was always the good thing. That was the gut feeling that, that you're referring to. But I think that's more on the myth, a myth rather than a reality. What we found with Aristides, we're not Harvard educated, by the way, that worked well in our business, is that we try to be disciplined. You don't try to get swayed by what the company next door is doing. I think we are pride ourselves that in the midst of the boom where asset prices were through the sky, we managed to refrain from investing in exorbitant prices and not put our company then at risk. And that was done with two things: common sense, of course, and discipline approaching to investing and trading. If you had a model that said, if it's above X, you don't buy, you don't buy it. If I look at Apostolos that buys, and say, he must know something more than me, I'll buy two. This is what creates the interesting aspect of shooting, the cycles, the booms and the busts.
Tasos, you are dealing with a lot of private equities these days, and you have been dealing with these private equities at least 3-4 years or even longer. What did they get wrong in 2012 when they were analytical? They are probably more analytical than most of the Greek shipping companies. What are the differences?
That's a really good question, and I'll try and do it justice. You're absolutely right. I mean, these institutional investors that have put a lot of money into the shipping industry, probably close to, I would say, over $50 billion over the last 4 years or so. And I would say, in general, gentlemen, jump in if I'm getting something wrong, but I think very few of them have actually made money from their investments in shipping up to this point. At best, they're breaking even. Some have made some money, but most of them are stuck in positions which are not necessarily profitable as of now. These guys will sit and look at every aspect of the shipping industry from a macro perspective, from a supply side, from the demand. They will look at every conceivable idea that, you know, that will influence a decision. I think where they may have come up short is from the point of view of not necessarily looking at a kind of from understanding how the interplay of all these factors influencing shipping, the global economy. Shipping is unique in that there are so many variables in this industry that can impact and have a result in the outcome of an investment decision that nobody can accurately predict what's going to happen. You can only make an educated guess, I would say, based on the available facts, but at any given point in time, a friend of mine pointed out, shipping is like having a jigsaw puzzle where everything is cloudy, and at any point in time you see a little bit of clarity, you see a little bit of the picture, and from that you've got to try and deduce what's happening in the world. And I think what private equity has not understood is that shipping is unlike any other industry. There are so many global, political, geopolitical, industrial, supply, everything that impacts the outcome of this industry. So I think where they've misunderstood perhaps is the fact that there are many elements of this industry, of this business, which are not, cannot be analyzed and predicted with anything with a huge degree of accuracy.
I have an additional take on that, why private equity potentially failed. It's because they weren't disciplined on their investment model. What is the model of a private equity firm? To find a company that's underperforming, take the company, fix it up, and add value. They saw shipping crashing in 2008-2009, and they thought it's an opportunity for them, but it was not. It was not that the shipping companies that were underperforming, it was that the industry was underperforming. No one in shipping has the ability to fix the industry, the market cycle. So private equity step away from their tested and successful recipe of finding problematic companies to invest in, fix them up, and sell them and make money. They made the mistake of doing that in an industry where they had no power in changing the economics, and that's why they got stuck. They made other mistakes too that had to do with the way they invested. I mean, they, by investing in new ships, which was the easier deal. If I tell you to buy a car, and I tell you to buy a second-hand car, you need to find a mechanic, to find a good car, check it. You need to have a partner, someone to do that for you, if you're not in the business. Alternatively, you can take your money and buy a new car. Then you're sure everything is fine. This is what the private equity did. They bought new ships, which destroyed the thesis. More ships changed the supply-demand equation and made the industry more difficult to recover.
The older days, it used to be big news when an owner, a Greek owner, used to put a 2+2 order in any shipyard, meaning two firm orders plus two options. And that was front page news in Lloyd's list 15 years ago. Within the past probably 7 years or 8 years, we have seen private equity guys in cooperation with companies placing orders with dozens plus dozens options. So they overextended themselves in addition to all the other issues that you mentioned.
Talking about these new building orders that Tassos talked about, we saw that the last 10 years, even the Greek shipping industry also get into this new building trend. And the profile has changed completely. I believe that Captain Tsakos, Captain Panayotis, was buying second-hand vessels, and the last 15 years, the company is buying new building vessels. Why is this difference? How this the profile of the Greek shipping fleet has changed so dramatically? What drove this? Is this good or bad?
I think it's a good thing. It shows that the companies do not stick with the old mentality, but they move on to new technology, to the requirements and the request of their clients. And eventually, the financing provided for those new buildings made it even easier. So as you know, being an ex-banker, so you can also give us your lights. I mean, there was ample liquidity in the past 15, 20 years for owners to take advantage. And the best business decision at that point was to place a new building order when owners also thought that the prices were at the right levels. So I think this is where, after the 80s, the Greek shipping industry changed, and from where you had owners buying second-hand vessels because Greeks always knew and they still know the best way to operate the older vessels, they decided it was a movement that basically guided them into placing orders for new buildings, for modern vessels, new technology, and of course with the help of financing being hugely available, it made it possible.
That's what your company pretty much abstains from new buildings. You have made some new building orders, but usually you are known for running second-hand vessels. Why are you still more focused on second-hand vessels? What is better? Is it better to buy a new car, an old car?
Well, I think it depends on the price. I think we believe, being disciplined investors, that every deal gets a price. You can buy an old ship for a very low price, and that'd be a good deal for you to make money. Buy an old ship for a higher price and lose money, and the same thing for a new ship. So we are not so much so ideologic about buying new versus old. We would do the investment that seems to have the biggest returns, and that is really what private when ship, Greek shipping companies were private. That was their model. They were trying to find their best investment to invest their own money. By going public, like many companies, Greek and non-Greek, and opening up to outside investors, you can argue that they lost a little bit track of the original mantra of you are there to make a return. Sometimes employing other people's money in your company gets some side benefits, and that was part of your decision making. So if you want to be specific and unbiased, but you try to invest at the ships, the projects that give you the best, I guess it's fair to say, risk-adjusted return. When I first got involved in shipping some decades ago, I was in Greece and I met the first Greek ship owner that I had seen up to that point. And he told me, I have a very simple model. I buy a ship 1 year before I have to scrap it. I buy 24 years. It makes sure that going to run for a year, do my calculations, take basically no risk. Have little equity, no risk. I'm doing this for so many years now. I mean, that model has obviously changed, hopefully for the better, but it requires more to be more on guard to avoid certain pitfalls that have to do with abundance of capital. That was the problem 10 years ago, and some other a little bit more complicated issues that you mentioned earlier that you have taken into account.
Also on the tanker business, the industry changed because of those terrible accidents that happened, and eventually owners could not operate older tanker vessels, and it was imperative that they move on to the next generation of vessels, double hull, new technology, safer and more are environmentally friendly vessels. So I think as far as the tanker business is concerned, it may be even more difficult to not avoid new buildings.
I would like to ask you, because of your experience having lived in London, having lived in Singapore, in Athens, and now New York, these are very different markets. What's the difference? What is the advantage? Why, I want to go back again, why people stay in Greece? What is the difference of, that you saw in Singapore? What is in Oslo, Oslo Sipona? Someone who wants to get involved in the city, what is the best place to go and live there?
Well, and obviously Greece has the best weather of all these places, so this is by far the easiest choice to make. I think what stands out for me about Greece is the fact that the expertise, you know, shipping is high profile industry in Greece. You know, everybody knows somebody who works in shipping, or somebody who's been at sea, or knows about, you know, shipping is a, in a way, for me, represents the aristocracy in Greece in terms of the mindset. I think what Greece offers in comparison to other places is the historical knowledge across every aspect of the business, whether this is operations, whether this is commercial, whether this is banking. So this skill set is unparalleled anywhere in the world. You have other countries which have pieces of it, but nothing to the extent that I think Greece possesses. And I think this is the cornerstone of why Greece is, it will continue to be a preeminent force in the industry for many years to come. Is that
okay? But Greece adjusts, and shipping adjusts. Yeah? I mean, if you look at shipping today, you would see it's a truly global industry. We build our ships in the Far East, in China, Korea, Japan. We mend them primarily, ships are expensive these days, with people from the Philippines, from Pakistan, from Ukraine. We buy insurance in the London market. We get our capital in the US. We have management expertise in Greece, as you say. So it's an industry that gets cherry-picking, picks the best for every location. It's a global industry. In an effort to try to make an efficient product to carry the goods and services that all of us use, or the, our industries use in producing wealth.
What about New York? Why we are all in New York right now?
Capital is here, relatively cheap capital. Also, New York, if you think about it, it's a big port. I mean, we tend to, in shipping, to ignore it, but it's a big port. It's a huge industry around the capital markets, a big arbitration center. I mean, arbitration shipping is part of your daily life. The legal system of New York is the United States in New York is preferred for all kinds of bankers and other cases in shipping. So New York has to offer a lot. The only problem in New York, even the tax system here is very favorable to shipping. The only problem is that the cost of living is high compared to other countries, for example. But New York is a place which could become a significant hub for nurturing shipping companies.
I want to go on the tax issue, because there's a lot of discussion in the media, in the Greek society, even in the US, about shipping does not pay taxes. And what is the contribution? I mean, I touched a little bit upon it earlier, on the contribution of the GDP, but how does it contribute, and why it doesn't pay taxes? Pays these taxes? And what would happen if Greece pays taxes? And how does this compare with other countries, with Germany, with the US, with Oslo?
Right. I think one has to really look into the details when it comes to giving a fair answer to this question. I think, as you very correctly mentioned earlier, the contribution of Greek shipping to the Greek GDP is something in the region of, I think, shy of $20 billion a year. So the companies, really, what are the companies, the shipping companies? They are the vessels, they are the ships. The ships generate earnings worldwide. They do not generate earnings in Greece. However, by having the operation, the base, the headquarters in Greece, all the people who work for shipping companies are being taxed on their income from, you know, their shipping employment.
Including ship owners.
Ship owners have a very favorable tax structure in place, but this is something that has been done for the past 40, 50 years. And if one looks at the contribution of the principals, not from the tax perspective, but from their contribution to society, then there is somehow something given back to the society.
Let me focus on that, because this is an issue that it has a lot of controversy.
What will happen
if the Greek government comes out and say, I'm going to have a 35, 40, 50, 60, I don't know how much is the corporate tax increase that goes up every day.
Right.
What it will happen to shipping, and how does this compare with the other shipping hubs? Because I assume that it's a global industry, you need to be aligned with the rest of the world.
Correct. I don't know what will happen. The answer, to be fair with you. I don't know if companies and owners will decide to move their companies overseas. What I know is that until then, no one has made any plans or has made any arrangements to move their companies. Our company is one probably of the few companies that have openly went out there and told the press that whatever happens to the tax system, will be increased no matter what. Going back to the tax regime for shipping companies in other countries, one has to look into the details. I mean, the Germans, they have had an extremely favorable tax treatment for the shipping companies throughout the past 10, 15 years, 20 years, but, you know, there's not much in the press for that, you know. In Singapore, for example, there's also some advantages, but I don't think that the Greek shipping is threatened by that. I think eventually there will be a formula where everyone's happy. And I think the owners are here to stay. I think the fact that, as Tasso mentioned, the expertise, the concentration of expertise in Greece is so big that even if a company was to move their operation in another country, eventually they would have a higher cost of operations because they would either have to bring all the people from Greece to work with them there, or they would have to hire people in the other regions, and that might have been more expensive. So I don't know if I answered your question. Obviously, this is a very big sort of discussion that's been going on. I think Greek shipping has made very clear that they're there to stay, they're there to support the Greek government, irrelevant of who's in power, and they're there to support the Greek economy. And they've been doing that directly and indirectly all these years.
Because shipping is an international business, it's very difficult to tax it in a specific jurisdiction. That's why many countries, Greece included, but pretty much every country, taxes shipping on a fixed base in terms of tonnage. How big is your ship? You pay certain taxes. They don't look at the income the ship generates. Even if they looked at the income, the various jurisdictions, the income is produced internationally. It's very hard to say that the income should be taxed in Germany if it was produced in Africa, because the ship provides service in Africa. So I guess, I mean, in the US, you pay tax on your personal part of that income and you have the obligation. I presume the same is true across the world. When the income comes to you as an individual, you have to deal with it tax-wise. I believe, without being a lawyer, I believe in the Greek constitution there is a provision for the shipping to be tax-free. I'm not 100% sure, so I don't want to.
But just to clarify, when you ship a good, somebody pays a tax, no? When Walmart buys a commodity, it has to pay a duty tax sometimes, and somebody has to pay the tax.
Correct, on the product.
So I assume that the tax is already embedded, the worldwide tax is embedded in the cost of capital of the industry.
I imagine, again, I'm not the expert to say that, when you, on the port services that you get, when you go to a port, there is the appropriate tax that applies. But when you move from the port, you are not in anybody's jurisdiction. You are in international water. So the service is provided along the globe in a no jurisdiction area. And I'm not sure how that, again, was given a lawyer to talk about it rather than me. I'm not sure there. But another little, I wouldn't say myth, but misperception is that the Greek ship owners don't pay tax. I think recently, in the middle of the crisis, Greek ship owners paid voluntarily three times the tonnage tax that was in the books to contribute to the Greek state to address whatever issue. So they're trying to contribute on their own, either through this offer on the triple tax or socially with their other deeds and investments.
Let me add a different parameter, because usually we're thinking about taxes on an income basis, and shipping since at least the last 2 years and most of the last 8 years does not make any money.
Correct. It still pays tax, right? You pay tax on the vessel even while you have a huge operating losses.
Just, I want to give some numbers and just to go a little bit more on the industry side and what is happening right now. 2008, the Capesize vessel was bought by George Economou for $70 million. I believe today is something like around $30 million. So some people lost a lot of money since 2008. I was looking at the numbers that the volume of shipping last year increased by just 1.4%. And compared to 2.3% in 2014, that's a steep decline even from the previous years. And however, the market continues to grow. It's most likely shipments are growing this year by around 2% across the different sectors. But the problem is oversupply. It's supply grows by 3-4%, 3.5% approximately. How do you make money in this industry? Everybody can come in and go, and money is available. Tassos can find you as much money as you want from the
I'm getting the money.
But at the end of the day, the ships are burning cash.
That's great.
How do you make money? What do you give your money to?
I think you are trying to, I mean, it's a very difficult situation in certain segments, like the dry bulk and containers. And what you try to do, you basically try to survive. You try to protect your investments and weather out the down part of the cycle. Avoid selling at the bottom of the cycle. I mean, there was, when I was in school, there was a seminar in post paper that was written, the secret in shipping was buy low, sell high, of course. That is the secret. If you buy at the bottom and sell at the top, that this is how you make money. But and the ideal strategy is to buy at the bottom, sell at the top, wait, buy again at the bottom, and this type of thing, like in the stock market. I mean, ship owners make money not only by operating ships, but by buying and selling ships as well. So what you do now is you try to find sources to invest in the segments that my company operates. We're at the bottom of the cycle, we're scraping the bottom of the barrel. So if you invest now, you could have tremendous returns if the market returns somewhat to the previous upswings of the cycle. So we're trying to work our cash flow, we're trying to find targeted investments.
What makes you confident that the cycle will turn? Shipping is it looks like an industry that industrial revolution, we went through the technological revolution, internet. I was hearing earlier today about biotech. Why don't you sell these ships, scrap them, and they've been losing money since 2008, and go to biotech?
The industry will recover. The question is whether you will be alive when it recovers. Because there are certain, like in every industry, there are certain correcting mechanisms in shipping too. If the market is lousy as it is now, it doesn't make sense to keep around a ship that doesn't make you much money, that doesn't make you money, or a ship that loses you a lot of money. So remove that ship, you scrap it, you send it for steel. You reduce the supply of ships otherwise too, by putting some ships, by mothballing some ships, putting them out of the market. You refrain from ordering. So there are ways that the industry reacts and adjusts, corrects itself, and eventually recovers. Whether the shipping demand grows at 5% or at 1%, eventually there will be a balance. That's why we say shipping is an industry, still an industry where supply, the interaction of supply and demand is what determines the level of rates and prices. So it is the true industry to test all your economic models.
Let me challenge that, because there are a lot of industries that in the 1920s and 1930s were thriving and do not exist today.
Right.
What makes you confident that this industry that has been this gutter since 2008 is going to come out?
On the macro level, there are not many alternatives to shipping, to seaboard transportation. I mean, how do you carry 100,000 tons of coal? Unless you would get into the Star Trek there and you can beam them up and beat them down, then you have to put them not in a plane, it's too expensive, on a ship.
And just to give you another, I mean, obviously, I totally agree with that, but the prediction is by the year 2022, 76% of the Chinese population will be considered middle class. So, just get an idea of where we're heading. And this is just China. The population increases worldwide in such a fast pace that it's impossible to serve the needs of all this population by other means of transportation. I mean, 90% of, you know, all goods are being transported by, you know, by vessels, all different types of vessels. And I personally am a very firm believer of this trend that eventually population will increase so much and the middle class will increase so much in places like China and India, where you will see the need for transportation increasing. And that, of course, will bring up shipping as well. And that's why we think that, yes, we're in a part of a cycle, a business cycle, a business, we know that, we operate under this concept, and we believe we'll eventually.
Because the industry can adjust to external shocks by adjusting the supply, then it can only blame itself from any malaise it finds itself in.
Right.
By ordering too many ships, now in this case, maybe through the help of private equity, is what caused the extended down cycle that we're facing.
Tassos, let me ask you, because you're not directly affiliated with any of the shipping companies, so hopefully you're going to try to give a little bit more impartial view. And what I want to ask, I mean, it's when the market is growing, it's great, but having a growth rate from 2-3% going down to 1%, and what makes you believe that it's not going to go down to -1%, and when the things start shrinking, then the whole psychology of the industry is shrinking. What makes you think that with electric cars today, we're going to need to transport oil? What makes you think that having the 3D printers and having Netflix, we're going to need to transport in container ships DVDs and all this equipment that the container ships carry?
That's a good question. To the best of my knowledge, I don't think trade has contracted for any period of time, for an extended period of time. I think that the general course of global trade has always been increasing, sometimes more aggressively than others, and I don't see anything that's going to derail that process in the long term. So I don't think that, you know, we're going to see any, the reason why shipping will continue to be an important industry globally is because there's no efficient way of being able to transport these quantities of oil, refined products from containers, dry commodities, in a cost-efficient way. And this is a very volatile business. It's prone to, you know, peaks and troughs related to oversupply or weaker demand, and that's going to continue to feature. This is also what makes this business very attractive. because if you have the ability to read the market intelligently and the gut, it's a very simplistic way of thinking about it, but it remains a very important element in terms of your decision making, your experience, and you know your understanding of how everything interacts. Will continue to be an important factor in terms of deciding what the time to invest is. Greeks don't see this as a short-term investor. They see this as a long-term business. They're not there to get, you know, put their money in shipping for 2 years and then go and put their money out into biotech in the next 5 years. Perhaps that might be something better to do sometimes, but at the moment, Greeks are committed to the industry, and in general, they make money, but again, the secret is, as somebody said, the secret to making a small fortune in shipping is to start with a large fortune.
Apostoli, would you like to add something? I mean, electric cars, Ubers, I mean, shale production is growing, US imports are declining. OPEC wants to cut production. That's is there a role for tankers?
That's good. I mean, we see the positive side of all this. I mean, obviously, the more oil is out there, the more needs to be transported from A to B. So the answer is yes for the tanker business. We see the more oil being produced, a good thing for our business.
But if it is consumed domestically, you can have a pipeline of moving.
Yes, but as you know, the U.S. still imports a great deal of oil, and it's not just the U.S. It's the emerging markets and South America. So we see new routes being appearing all the time from West Africa to Asia, which was not around a few years ago. We see U.S. crude oil being exported. We see new markets being developed, like not new markets necessarily, but we see, for example, Iranian oil coming up in the market. We see Iraqi oil appearing. We see the Libyan oil coming up in the market as well. So the way we look at it is that no one will produce unless they can sell. So if there's more oil produced, it has to be transported. So a good thing for the tanker business, and we consider this to be an advantage moving forward. The expectation as far as demand is concerned, as you know, it's approximately 1.3 to 1.4 million barrels per day for the next couple of years. What we worry about, as Tasso said again, is the supply. It's the new building orders, it's the number of vessels that's been available. As far as demand is concerned, we feel that demand will be healthy and will be there to support the cyclicality of our business.
Before we go to the supply factor, the supply is something that you decide at the end, but let's talk a little bit about the externalities. Tell us about container ships. I mean, we read on Wall Street Journal, one of the few times that the Wall Street Journal devotes into shipping, about the Hanjin bankruptcy. The last time that we had such a large bankruptcy in shipping was the United States in the 80s, at that time that was the biggest bankruptcy in the U.S. What went wrong? And, is there a structural risk for container ships? The GDP growth around the world comes from services, not from goods. You have the printers, the 3D printers, people can press a button and they can produce directly at the home.
Of course, the global demand for goods, for finished goods, will determine the demand for shipping. In case of Hanjin, I think the slower growth of demand and the lower levels of earnings that the vessels produced, and the high leverage of the company and overextension, created a situation that would not be carried out forward. So it created, in the short term, a disturbance in the logistics of moving goods around. I mean, it was pretty far. I don't know whether you have looked into it at all, but if a ship carrying containers that Hanjin operated, if it was caught outside the board when the company went bankrupt, had to face all kinds of issues. No board would accept it to unload the cargo because nobody would be there to pay the port. The guys who owned the cargo, they felt that the products were trapped somewhere in the ocean because there was no place for the ship to go to. So it was a pretty big mess. But that is sorting itself out in the industry. I think your question, which relates to the previous one, is what if demand for shipping, seaborne transportation, goes down? It might very well be down the road. But still shipping, the capacity will adjust. It might take a period where some companies will go bankrupt, which, I mean, if you take the, you live here in the United States, it's healthy to cleanse an industry of the less healthy players. Some companies will go bankrupt, some capacity will be removed, but eventually will adjust. If the world demand declines 1% a year, eventually supply will adjust to accommodate that. It might be a temporal problem during the transition, as it was a great situation in 2001 and 2008. The exogenous event there was that China was admitted to the World Trade Organization and became part of the world trade system. So that sent trade volumes through the roof. There was not enough supply to accommodate it, and some people made a lot of big fortunes, and in 2008-09, many lost them.
Do you want to give us your view about, use your analytical skills and gut feeling about container ships, and this is an interesting sector. Would
sure.
you buy container ships right now? Would you invest into this sector?
We would carefully invest on good quality units. We wouldn't buy anything, but a ship that had low, big factor in container ships, how much fuel it consumes. A ship that has good fuel consumption, because the prices are ridiculously low, would be a good investment for container ships. You might have to budget some cash support for the investment for the next year or two, but we just bought a ship a month ago, actually an older container ship. But we see the market, the demand side being, as you say, a bit challenged in the next couple of years because of the reasons that you mentioned. Also, Europe, which has been a big importer of finished goods, has not really solidly recovered from the financial crisis. It's been crippling up between 0.5% and 1% growth every year, but that is not enough to boost the container sector. There's another game there. I don't know how much you should get into the container. There's another cost reduction game that some other liner companies are playing. But overall, I think we believe that in the near term, for selected units, we are investing. We're also investing on the dry bulk.
You are negative for the next couple of years, or cautious for the next couple of years.
We're cautious.
Why are you investing now and don't wait for 2 years later?
Because one of the things that happens in shipping is it happens in the stock market. When perceptions turn, you lose the turning point. If you don't buy early enough, you will buy twice the price. So if you are a long-term player and you want to be there and sort of build a position, you do it, again, carefully, as I said, you do it when the rates, the values are cheap. Discipline trade. When it's cheap, buy it.
So, Apostolic, when do you buy ships? Do you buy when the market is good, when the market is bad? When is the time to buy a ship?
Well, I can only speak, you know, for our company. We have been a counter-cyclical investor in ships, meaning we have
And when do you try? When do you make the best returns if you are successful in timing the market? At what time you have to get in? What time you have to come out?
You have to get in when there's blood on the streets. So when there's blood in the street, this is when you get in. So obviously, you know, when the prices of the new buildings are very competitive, this is when we believe that we have to place new building orders. In our case, we never do it without a charter coverage. So this is when we talk with all our counterparties and all the companies we do business with, and we structure a deal that makes sense for everyone. We might not make the most amazing returns, but we have a very stable business in place, and we're very happy with the returns that we make. to answer your question, when is really, it really comes down to each company's strategy and each company's capacity. So we think that, I mean, we have done that throughout the past 10 years. We have been buying vessels when the prices were at the lower part of the cycle. And this is where we have also tried to fix those vessels, placing new building orders, but at the same time, you know, bringing charter coverage, meaning that, you know, there are clients out there, there are companies out there that were willing to contract for 10, 12, 15 years with us. And we believe that, you know, it's a fair deal for everyone.
Tasos, I have seen that some of what Apostolis is saying, but in reality, you basically wouldn't have the money. And what you could tell me that people that they come to you and ask you for the money, what do they tell you, what do they want to buy? And you have been in, now you're following every sector, but you have been in dry bulk, you have been in tankers. Where would you put your money on?
My personal money?
Personal money, your client's money?
Well, I think we find ourselves in a kind of an unusual position in the shipping cycle where all the major sectors in the industry are more or less very down. Whether this is in the tankers, the dry bulk, the containers, the offshore space, the gas space, to varying degrees. And in terms of where I think the best value lies at the present moment, I think the container space is getting very interesting from the point of view that prices have come down to such an extent that the prices of ships is not far off from their scrap value at this point in time, you know, for relatively young ships. And I think that makes it an interesting point to consider investing in these types of assets. The dry bulk sector achieved kind of all-time lows at the beginning in Q1 of this year, and asset values followed suit. Prices have recovered. I would say there's cautious optimism in the future of that sector, and we're seeing renewed interest from people to go in and buy ships in these types of assets. Tankers, I think it's an interesting space, but I think it's something that we need to see how the demand picture picks up. But I think that it's not necessarily a time either to buy or sell at the moment. I think it's just kind of wait on the sidelines and see. There's only one long-term secret to being making money in shipping. It's basically making your timing of the acquisition right. And there's no magic formula as to how you achieve this. It's partially luck, it's partially judgment, it's partially reading the tea leaves in a way. But I think there are definitely, at any given point in time, there are opportunities in any given sector. And I think at the present moment, I think the container space and the dry bulk space is perhaps the most interesting in terms of where we are in terms of the asset values themselves.
You can do a deal at any point in the market. Right? This is what has changed in the industry. It has to do with the analysis that you mentioned earlier. It used to be that you buy at the bottom, and then you were sort of guaranteed to make money because the market would recover. Or to do it like the Greek gentleman I met 30 years ago, many years ago, to buy 1 year before scrap. But you can also buy a ship on the top of the market, as long as you can charter it out to some other user who pays you a rate that compensates for the high price you pay. Of course, that changes the analysis of the deal that you have to do. From a deal that was, is it at the bottom of the market, so I buy, goes to, will the guy who charter my ship be able to keep paying me? So changes the way you can always secure a return, but the analytical support, and that's why the industry is modernized and people do deals. I mean, we did a deal like that. We order a ship at the market that, at the price that by today's standards is considered high, but we were lucky or smart enough to charter it out for a period of time at a decent rate to cover the cost of our investment. So, and we controlled, hopefully we understood the credit quality of the person who is to pay us. So that, so far, kept the deal on the positive side, but required some analysis of different sort that the old Greeks used to do.
Yes,
it wasn't a dream.
Can you, Tasos, can you tell us about is the money there? You want to do a deal right now. It's great to buy containers, it's to buy dry bulk vessels. Can you find money to do it? Or you need to have the family money or the safe box?
I think that you're always going to need a degree of, you know, your own money to go out and buy ships. Traditionally, ships have been financed in a very simple manner. You know, the ship owner would have his own kind of pool of capital, whether it's his own or his friends and his family, and they would go to a bank and say, I found this beautiful ship, I want to buy it, I'm going to name it after my daughter, can you give me the money? And the banks will traditionally open up their things. It's certainly, you know, here's 50% of the value of the ship, you put the other 50% and you've got a deal. That environment is changing now. The people that were lending to the shipping industry for many years were predominantly the European banks. The banks in Germany, the banks in Greece, the banks in France, the banks in England. Because of what's happened in the Europe in the last few years, these banks are under intense pressure from bad debts. And one of the sectors where they think they don't consider it a core business for them is shipping. So we're seeing the trend across many of the lenders in Europe, they are reducing their exposure to the industry. This has made money much harder to come by in terms of going to the bank and having a conversation and being willing to finance you. They become much more selective in terms of which clients they choose to support. And that's resulted in many companies which are very good operators, very shrewd, very intelligent, not being able to get money from the banks. And this is the reality at the moment. And it looks, as it appears at the moment, that this is going to be a trend that's likely to continue. The European banks are going to reduce. American banks have never been very big participants in the shipping industry. So where does shipping find its money? This is really one of the reasons why we're seeing kind of the US institutional investors now playing a bigger role in the industry in terms of financing the aspirations of ship owners. And ship owners come with an idea, this is a great opportunity to invest, let's go and put some money to work, and more or less this has been the way it's happened. I think what's changing now is that we're seeing China become an ever more important participant in the industry in terms of providing capital. Previously they were lending only for ships that were going to be built, new ships that were going to be built in China, but now we're seeing them transition in terms of leasing ships, and also providing, in cooperation with European banks and also by themselves, providing capital through international loaners to buy second-hand ships as well as new buildings. So the world is changing. I think the US will remain important both in terms of the capital markets, which are very deep, and if they like shipping, there's huge amounts of money to work. I think private equity will remain a player in the space. I think European banks will probably become less so, and I think the potential growth area is going to come from the Far East, from China in particular.
Tassos and Apostolos, can you tell us, how do you finance a ship? Why this is an industry which is crazily volatile? VLCCs were making last year $20-25 million dollars within a year. This year, probably they are losing money. Why do you put debt into a ship which is so volatile, into an industry which has inherent leverage, and so much inherent leverage, and how much leverage do you put? What is the magic formula in financing a vessel?
In our case, the way we work is that the sweet spot is about 65% debt and 35% of our own equity. This is more or less the mix when it comes to our company. However, as Tasso mentioned, there's a lot of new forms of financing acquisitions nowadays. I must say that we have been very lucky that we have an excellent relationship with most of the banks that are still there to finance the shipping business. And we have not really yet run out of options in terms of the banks that we do business with. However, we see, as time goes by, more and more new forms of financing being available. In our case, to answer your question, the sweet spot is about 60-65% of debt for its acquisition, and 35% comes from our own.
Finding debt is obviously more difficult these days across the industry. We have been generally able to finance even longer ships with partly with debt or refinance some payments. But we had a new building that we took delivery, the one I mentioned earlier earlier this year, that we were able to finance at 60-something percent with debt. But it's getting harder. So if you have the equity, when you buy at the bottom, it's better to buy all equity. And some friends and associates bought certain ships that we are managing 100% equity at the bottom of the market. So your break-even cash flows are low, and you don't have any bank to go after you. And then when the market recovers, you can sort of put some debt on the vessel and take some of your investment out. So that is sort of the model that you are trying to do. If you have the equity, you use it. To the extent you can get some debt, also mind you, the best way to finance a ship at the bottom of the market is with debt, because then any increase on the price of the project goes directly to your pocket, doesn't go to the bank. So you try to do your utmost to get the right level of debt that doesn't strain your cash flows, and that would increase the returns of your investment. So it's, again, a little bit of analysis, a little bit of balancing of risk and return. What is the right combination of operating cash flow that I can support, that I can get to support my obligations?
I want you to have a final your final recommendation about where do you invest today. I mean, Tassos, you talked about dry bulk container ships, but do you invest buying a ship? Why not buy a stock? Which stock do you think is going to be the best, or which ship is going to be the best? Do you really need to buy a ship, or do you buy something else, real estate or infrastructure related? There's going to be a big infrastructure plan, spending plan here in the US, apparently. Is this going to affect any particular segment into shipping? Give us your final recommendation. Perhaps dry ships, it went up 1,000% in a week.
I think that shipping definitely is at the low part of the cycle after being there for quite some time. So it is tempting to say that it's an industry that is worth investing attention. Whether to buy stocks or ships is a very good question. I mean, for most people, buying ships is not feasible, I would imagine, although a creative person could create a solution, an offering that allows it. But the problem with stocks is that most of the shipping stocks, and I think Postal Company is one of the best ones, are very liquid. Our stock is relatively liquid, so if you put a lot of money into the stock, except the last 2 days, it would be difficult to sell them. So if you are a small investor, you can sort of do it, but if you want to put big money in, it's hard to do it. So if you want to invest in scale, investing in ships is the only avenue. If you, as an individual investor, perhaps selected stocks would make sense. I mean, maybe I'm a little biased. I think the dry bulk in particular is sort of right at the correct point to invest this year. And for the containers, I would think you have a little more of a window to invest.
Can you give us a stock recommendation?
I think liquid stocks, frankly. I mean, I would say stay with liquid stocks. Look at the volume, at how much is traded.
I'm asking for a ticker.
It's hard to. You can see the dry bulk stocks that were down, suddenly skyrocketed, and now they are probably still are a bit overpriced, including ours, I guess, or I don't know, but it's. The way things are moving, it's a bit funny in liquid stocks. It's hard to give us a specific stock.
That's what's...
I'll be telling my trade secrets if I told you a specific stock. Yeah. But I think it's an industry that isn't for the faint hearted. I think you can make a lot of money in shipping, but you can equally lose money pretty quickly. And I don't want to kind of sound negative, but it's an industry where, you know, I think doing your homework, speaking to people that are in the know, getting a lot of opinions, you form a knowledge about where certain sectors are. If I was going to put my own money to work, I would agree with Tassos. I think the dry bulk sector is perhaps the most interesting in terms of where it is in the cycle.
Which stock? There aren't so many liquid stocks in the dry bulk sector. Maybe I'm missing one, or I'm missing one, but there aren't that many liquid stocks.
I think it's important just to basically find a company that's doesn't have a huge amount of debt, that all assets at the right price, and that when the market recovers, it has the ability to do so in terms of capturing deals.
So practically, you're not investing in anything because there's not such a company.
Well, shipping is bread and butter. I think, you know, we will invest in shipping, irrelevant of, you know, what's going on in the market, because this is what we do for a living. However, the two main drives is going to be new technology and people. So what will we look to invest is new technology when it comes to the tankers, and when it comes to LNGs in particular, which is something that we are looking very, very carefully right now. And people, at the end of the day, this business, it's all about vision. And that's what we have been taught from history. Shipping has been built and has been structured on vision. I mean, in 1873, the first steamship acquired by a Greek named Theophylactopoulos, if I'm not mistaken. It was the first steamship. And this is when nobody knew about it. Nobody knew how a steamship operates. This owner started a steamship revolution in Greek shipping. So when it comes to our company, we're looking at new technology, we're looking at investing in people, and always, you know, with the vision of, you know, having a sustainable model for our business.
With that, I want to thank you, Lou. Thank you, Wamka. I think this is a fascinating industry. Wherever you're going to invest, whatever you decide, I think that it's worth to invest the time. And I will share with you something that when I first joined Morgan Stanley, one of our oil analysts told me that regardless how big, how good, how bad the shipping industry is, this is the only industry that has one company is trying to out-party the other. This is the industry that has the best parties in the world. People is a small community, is a large, small community, very close to each other, and they have an amazing time whether the market is up or down. Thank you very much.
The word that you use is absolutely true. Fascinating. This was a fascinating, very interesting panel discussion. And I'd really like to thank all of you for being here. When I was listening to some of this conversation, I was thinking of the real estate industry, actually. And I was thinking, when you were talking about the cycles, I was thinking of the development cycles and what takes place in New York real estate. I'd like everyone to give a super round of applause. I would like, quite frankly, to do this as a yearly event in this particular industry, that we can, you know, meet on a yearly basis and basically discuss what's happening currently. As it relates to taxes, because I heard that conversation about the taxes, because you were pushing them about the taxes. A lot of the shipping companies were actually based in New York at one time. And when in fact the Hellenic Republic wanted to get them over to Greece, one of the things that they did discuss was in fact taxes. And in my opinion, and I believe historically, that's why it was embedded in the Hellenic Constitution, and that's why all of a sudden you had a lot of these shipping companies heading towards Greece. So, reduce taxes, increase the volume of trade, etc., to actually increase taxes in different sources. Thank you all tonight, and again, a round of applause for you. We'll be right back.
MGTV USA. Οι δραστηριότητες της ελληνοαμερικανικής κοινότητας με βίντεο και πλήρες ρεπορτάζ.